Tonight, an upper-level trough dumps heavy rains on the island, forcing the closure of schools and putting flood and landslide communities on high alert. A 45-foot catamaran with a four-member crew is the first Arc Plus participant to cross the finish line. And efforts get underway here to establish a rape crisis center. Very good evening to you on this wet Tuesday. Welcome to another edition of the DBS News World. My name is Timothy Polio. Our top story, the National Emergency Management Organization, NEMO, put St. Lucians on alert today after an upper-level trough dumped several millimeters of rain on the island and triggered thunderstorms overnight and into this morning. The system continued to produce showers and isolated thunderstorms throughout the day, causing NEMO to advise persons in low-lying areas to be on guard. DBS's Don Nicholas begins our news
coverage. National Emergency Management Organization, NEMO, emphasized that the Met Office had already indicated that there would be isolated showers and thunderstorms associated with an upper-level trough. With the soil already saturated from previous showers, NEMO is urging citizens to be on the alert for landslides.
In essence, it means that we should not lay our guards down, but do everything that we have been advising persons from the beginning of the year. In and out of the hurricane season, we need to understand that right now, because of climate change, there is no real dry and wet season.
NEMO is also urging persons who live in low-lying areas to be on guard. The organization is also warning pedestrians not to cross flooded streets for fear they get injured.
Because you never know what is there. Under the water could be a massive hole, so you could break your leg, you could fall in a ditch, or there could be power lines that are down, which are live. So for these reasons, we encourage persons not to cross flooded paths.
NEMO is urging the public to pay close attention to all official weather reports. For the DBS News World, I'm Don Nicholas.
And just hours away from the official close of the rainy season, the island has been pounded by rains, thunderstorms and strong winds. The upper-level trough affecting the region caused the flooding in some areas and snapped tree branches in others. But Met officials say this weather pattern is part of a growing trend.
One day shy of the closure of the Atlantic hurricane season, the island continues to be affected by a trough system.
It began affecting St. Lucia sometime yesterday. It has produced a lot of rainfall in some parts of St. Lucia. Some places in the south of the island recorded in excess of 100 millimeters in the 24-hour period that ended at 8 this morning. At present, the system is still around. The atmosphere is very moist and unstable, and we're expecting more showers and thunderstorms later during the day.
Drawing reference to Hurricane Thomas in 2010 and the Christmas Eve trough in 2013, the director highlighted what has developed to be a trend around this time of year.
This time of year, trough systems, they are more prevalent this time of year than other times. Earlier during the hurricane season, what brought us rainfall was more tropical waves and tropical depressions and tropical cyclones. But for the month of November into December, the troughs, that is the feature that brings us most of our rainfall.
Residents in low-lying areas prone to flooding have been asked to remain on guard, while fishermen have been asked to remain in port. The upper-level trough system is expected to continue to affect the islands into Wednesday. For the DBS News World, Sheffield Gillard reporting.
In other news, tourism officials are reporting a dip in bookings out of the U.S. this season. This is in keeping with pre-election predictions about travel to and from the U.S. in light of Donald Trump's election to the presidency. While travel to the United States will be dictated by Trump's immigration policies, experts say outbound travel depends on the health of the U.S. economy under his stewardship, since a weaker dollar could deter Americans from leaving home. Don Nicholas tells us more.
Tourism authorities are noting a dip in bookings. The St. Lucia Hotel and Tourism Association says it's as a result of the just concluded presidential elections. However, they are optimistic that they will see an increase.
So we are happy to discount the current lag in bookings to that effect. And now that we have passed and we have gone beyond that, we're optimistic that we will see an increase in these bookings over the winter season. Right now, the feedback reaching me is that there is still tremendous room for improvement in terms of our booking forecast.
Tourism Minister Dominic Fede is optimistic about the future. However, he says factors such as the Brexit vote and the devaluation of the pound have played a major role in the dip in bookings.
People want to come to St. Lucia. The destination continues to have tremendous demand and continues to be well regarded among the travel trade in the UK. But I think we need to counteract some very new things that are happening. Destinations like Dubai and so on are very aggressive and have become a lot stronger in their marketing and certainly have penetrated the UK market. So I think it's a combination of things.
Fede pointed out that his government is doing all in its power to revive the UK market. For the DBS News World, I'm Don Nicholas.
Time now for Street Vibes. Here's your presenter.
Hi, I'm Alex Buske, and you're watching Street Vibes. The former Cuban president and commander-in-chief, Fidel Castro, died last week, Friday. What is your take on his life and ruling?
His life based on St. Lucia, because he helped quite a few persons because of him that St. Lucia, most of St. Lucia are not blind. Because when you walk to the VH and you go there, Monday to Friday, you get hundreds. And because of him, he have contributed a great thing for our fellow people in St. Lucia. So his personal way have been touching souls and lots of people because he was a great leader, not only for his country, but for the Caribbean on the whole. So that's number one, I must say. Have a good one.
Well, boy, I think we lost a great man. A great man. And one of the most amazing, although it may seem small, one of the most amazing things about Fidel was his prophecy, for lack of a better word, about exactly what would have happened. He says, America will meet with Cuba when the world has a Latin American pope and a black U.S. president, and it happened. And we can see, despite everything that has happened with Cuba and all of the embargoes they have, always stayed buoyant, always stayed on top of their game. So, of course, he's somebody who should be celebrated for eternity.
Actually, what I need to say is congratulations on their government and the opposition as well for congratulating the government of Cuba, which they have done several things for St. Lucia. I'm not a doctor, but I achieved from the medical unit where they're seen all over the world, especially when Ebola and Zika, all those sicknesses took place in the diaspora. What I need to say is that I'm congratulating, I'm not too educated, but I need to use the word as it is. I'm congratulating the Cuban community. I'm sympathizing with the government and Mr. Alan Chastney as well. On behalf of Mr. Fidel Castro, it's a sad time now for the world. It's not only because of St. Lucia, because he have assisted us in several phases. Actually, most of our professional doctors, they are from Cuba.
You've just been watching Street Vibes with me, Alex Buske, down here at the Aquarius Crossing, the intersection of Coral and St. Louis Streets. With that, we'll take you back to our studio.
Thank you very much, Alex. You are watching St. Lucia's television and news leader and listening to us on Rhythm FM 95.5. We are also online and the big screen at the Aquarius Crossing in downtown Castries. Still to come, remembering Cuba's special relationship with CARICOM, and work begins on establishing a rib center here. Thank you so much for staying with the broadcast. Advocacy group Raise Your Voice St. Lucia has launched an online fundraising campaign for the establishment of a rape crisis center. The center, if it materializes, will provide counseling, crisis intervention, and other support services by those affected by sexual violence. More in this report.
The secretary of Raise Your Voice St. Lucia, Ms. Catherine Seelies, explains that a center for victims of rape was one of the priority items contained in a declaration for action document submitted to the government of St. Lucia earlier this year. She believes that it is something that the organization can undertake.
Victims of rape don't have anywhere to go. Domestic violence victims have somewhere to go, but victims of rape don't have anywhere to go. So we were hoping that by December next year, we would have had raised the necessary funds to establish this center so we can offer counseling support, psychological support, advocacy services, legal aid, and other support for victims of rape and sexual abuse.
Ms. Seelies says, given the prevalence of rape and sexual assault on the island, such a center is necessary.
The other things we had asked from the government was the recommissioning of the forensic laboratory. This has not been done, but we're hoping that the Minister of National Security has kept his word and is working towards that. The enactment of the OECS family law bills to ensure the change of legislation so that single parents can get a little more than $200 to maintain a child. $200 does not maintain a child in St. Lucia. And we also ask for to upgrade the capacity of the DPP office and the police to better so people can get swifter justice.
The fundraising drive began on Tuesday, 29th November 2016. Ms. Seelies is urging everyone to contribute as sexual assault knows no bounds in terms of age, gender, sexual orientation, income level, or location.
We're getting help from Global Giving, but they're matching every dollar we raise. So if we raise $10, they give us $10. So we encourage St. Lucians to find us online and donate. The significance is that people who are raped or sexually abused can have a place to go for help and support. We cannot have people not getting help after going through such a traumatic situation. So we're asking ladies, we're asking the men, we're asking everybody to step up. The minimum donation is 10 US. Make a donation, share it, speak to people about it, and let us work on this together.
To make a donation, persons are asked to log onto the website at www.ryvslu.org and click onto the globalgiving.org icon and donate as little or as much as they can towards that very important cause. For the DBS News World, Sheffield Gillard reporting.
As world leaders gather in Cuba to pay their final respects to dead Cuban President Fidel Castro, journalist Earl Bosque has been recounting Cuba's invaluable contribution to regional development. CARICOM member states and Cuba have an over three-decade bond dating back to 1972 when the communist country set up diplomatic relations with Barbados, Jamaica, Guyana, and Trinidad and Tobago. Since then, every member of CARICOM has followed suit. Alex Buske tells us more.
The relations between St. Lucia and Cuba, he says, were shaped by Fidel Castro himself.
After independence, and St. Lucia established diplomatic relations with Cuba, Fidel Castro ensured that the scholarships that were offered to St. Lucia and subsequently to other countries were aimed primarily at ensuring that the sons and daughters of poor St. Lucians who could not afford university education for their bright children to get those opportunities. And you would notice that the first set of St. Lucians who studied in Cuba were along those lines.
One of the very special moments Mr. Buske recalls happened when the president or El Comandante learned that St. Lucia was in the process of building a new hospital and there would be a great need for nurses.
He ordered that a hospital be built in Cuba, in the province of Matanzas, specifically to train St. Lucian nurses for those two hospitals. Subsequently, other OECS countries were able to send nurses to that institution, which was itself too large for just St. Lucia alone. And subsequent to that, St. Lucia continued to benefit from the Operation Milagra, where over 10,000 St. Lucians were able to get their eyes done, either here or in Cuba, free of charge under that program.
Earl Bosque also took issue with those who celebrated Castro's death.
When we listen to the things being said about Castro by Cubans in Miami who are jumping and dancing at the fact that somebody is dead. It shows how heartless, how cruel, how mindless they are when they can dance and jump on the grave of a dead person. It is very significant to point out, however, that it is the older Cubans who left Cuba and went to Miami on their own free will who are the ones demonstrating.
Over the past three general elections held in the U.S., Mr. Buske says the majority of Cubans in Florida voted the Democrats in order that Barack Obama would open up Cuba once again. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Buske.
And now the story, the tourism sector is moving to make life more comfortable for differently abled visitors. The initiative seeks to build on the theme for this year's observance of World Tourism Day, which focuses on accessibility. The idea is that everyone has the right to access leisure and tourism services on an equal basis, including people around the world living with disabilities, those traveling with young children, seniors and persons with other access requirements. Don Nicholas explains.
As part of the commemoration of World Tourism Day, tourism authorities are looking at accessibility as it relates to the differently abled. Many of the resorts have made provisions for such persons, but authorities say there is room for improvement.
The intention this morning is to have discuss with our operators, specifically small properties and sites and attractions, to determine what is currently available as it pertains to our tourism product in terms of facilitating differently abled persons when they visit, whether they be wheelchair bound, blind, etc. Also coming out of today's forum, we intend to put some recommendations together.
According to officials, research has indicated that the differently abled travel just as much as regular individuals. The onus is therefore on the tourism sector to make the stay of such persons with disabilities as comfortable as possible.
And what we're seeing is a greater integration of that concept in the landscaping and in the construction of various properties within the tourism industry. And for us, that is one way in which we can make our properties more easily accessible for individuals who are physically challenged.
Officials say generally the feedback from visitors is positive. For the DBS News World, I'm Don Nicholas.
The first boat of the Arc Plus, Spirit, has crossed the finish line at Rodney Bay. The 45-foot catamaran registered in Guernsey with a crew of only four crossed over from Cape Verde in 12 days. Alex Buske has their story.
Keith Hardy, the captain of the 45-foot catamaran Spirit, says they left Cape Verde with very light winds all the way until they encountered the inclement weather between St. Lucia and Martinique.
36 hours. We had a lot of squalls coming in close to these islands and vicious squalls and lightning storms. And it was hard work, very, very hard work. But we made it. We're in one piece. And we're here in St. Lucia, and we're just absolutely ecstatic.
Keith and his wife, Claire Hardy, who is a police officer back in the UK, have only been sailing a little over a year, and already they have started a world tour.
Then we thought, well, instead of just buying a motorboat, let's buy a sailing boat and sail around the world, and we don't need a house at all. And so that's what we did, and we decided to sail around the world. We put a stake in the ground. May the 1st is when we were going to leave in 2 years' time. And we did, dead on the day. And we looked around the websites and found the Ark to help us cross the Atlantic, because we only started sailing in May last year with no experience of sailing. And we've learnt a lot very quickly.
Crew member Nigel Edwards says his most unpleasant time of the entire voyage was at the end of it all.
Relieved after the last 36 hours that we completed it in the storm that we finished in. But yeah, it was a great crossing, and we had a great crew, and we have sunny sailing days virtually every day.
My name is Dirk de Ploy. I'm from Belgium, and I'm also sailing from age of 15. And this is my second time. Last year I did the Ark, and this year I the Arc Plus. It was a nice experience.
Captain Keith Hardy says he intends to stay on St. Lucia for a bit, then explore the other Caribbean islands in a time frame of 2 years. But first, he says, he and his wife will have family and friends join them here in St. Lucia for the festive season. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Bousquet.
Meanwhile, the general manager of the IGY Marina at Rodney Bay was full of praise for the crew of the 45-foot catamaran, which placed first in the ARC Plus race.
We're here today to, because of the arrival of the first Arc Plus boat, Spirit, and the name says it all. We'd like to welcome them to St. Lucia and IGY Rodney Bay Marina as we look forward to the 70 other boats coming to our shores. We look forward to showing them the island and what it has to offer, and look forward to putting on a show as we can do in St. Lucia and attracting all these sailors coming to our shores.
The crew of the 45-foot catamaran crossed from Cape Verde to St. Lucia in 12 days. They arrived at the Rodney Bay Marina at 3 a.m. on Tuesday. When the DBS News World continues, the curtains come down on Business Month. Welcome back to the broadcast. The newly built Royalton Hotel at Cap Estate is getting set to open its doors and has begun the search for persons to fill several positions within the company. We hear more in this report.
The Royalton Hotel at Cap Estate is getting set to open up its doors for business. At this stage, the hotel is 90% ready, according to the general manager.
We're pleasantly surprised. We sent an ad out about 3 weeks ago in the newspapers here, and we received over 6,000 applications. We're hoping to do just under 3,000 interviews in the next eight working days, and our final selection would be just under 1,000. It's a great feeling, it's a win-win. St. Lucia is a great destination. The service level here is very high for the English-speaking Caribbean, and people are very excited about us being here, and it's a win-win. As I said, we're very excited about being in St. Lucia. It's still very exotic, sometimes relatively unknown, which I think it's a winning formula to maintain the room rates here and possibly to push it up a little higher, which would help all of us.
Human Resource Manager Sancha St. Rose Phillips says the interviews conducted were for a variety of positions, with applicants ranging from 18 to 30 years old.
The response was overwhelming. Like Mr. Dan Paul mentioned, we did have over 6,000 applications. Basically what we're doing, we're going out into the communities. Our interviews are basically scheduled per district. Today we're actually in Groseillers, so we will be doing a lot of interviews for the residents of Groseillers, Moshi, etc. Tomorrow we're going to be in Babono. How we plan to do it though is actually calling persons to schedule an interview so that they have a specific time and everything flows, so nobody's actually waiting to be seen. So everybody's allotted a 15 to 30 minute period, so that way we can afford them that interview within that specific time period.
These interviews were conducted at the training room of the St. Lucia Hotel and Tourism Association office at Rodney Heights on Monday. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Bousquet.
The month of November has been a vibrant one for the local business sector, as a number of activities were held as part of Business Month. The initiative was organized by the Department of Commerce, International Trade, Investment, Enterprise Development and Consumer Affairs, in conjunction with the Trade and Export Promotion Agency, TEPA, and a number of other sponsors. The aim of Business Month was to generate discussion on entrepreneurship in St. Lucia. Through the month-long calendar of activities, Business Month was able to sensitize the public on the core functions and services of the ministry and its support units and agencies. Business Month was supported this year by Caribbean Export Development Agency and the Ministry of Agriculture, Food Production, Fisheries and Rural Development, with support from Invest St. Lucia, St. Lucia Coalition Service Industries, St. Lucia Bureau of Standards, Small Business Development Center, and the St. Lucia Hotel and Tourism Association. The annual Stratford Cause charity fashion show held over the weekend is being hailed as a success by organizers. This year, they teamed up with the police to raise public awareness about mental illness and to help people better understand the complexities of mental health. More in this report.
Issues of mental illness don't usually take center stage unless some traumatic, tragic incident befalls a mentally ill person. The seeming apathy in the society towards individuals and institutions providing care to the mentally ill is also widespread. But on Saturday, November 26th, staff of the St. Lucia National Mental Wellness Center, the police, alongside professional models, strutted elegantly down the catwalk at Sandals Grand in a fundraising effort towards the cause of mental illness. Executive Director of Mental Health Services, Charmaine Hippolyte Thomas, was ecstatic that this year's Strut for a Cause event, organized by Valerie Albert Favory and Delia Fossoir, focused on mental health. She said the Ministry of Health, via the Mental Wellness Center, is committed to combat stigma and discrimination towards the mentally ill.
Tonight's activity is an excellent indication that persons do understand the concerns of mental health. Voluntary groups and concerned citizens have gathered here to support the Strut for a Cause project, which is aimed at supporting the newly opened psychiatric unit for children and adolescents at the Wellness Center.
Police Commissioner Severin Morshery, who also did some strutting of his own, stated that it was quite timely for the police to be part of this activity, particularly as it fell within the celebration of Police Week under the theme, The Community and the Police, a Partnership in Action.
Last year, because we realized that people were getting injured, people who were mentally ill were getting injured, and some of them losing their lives at the hands of the police, we decided to introduce a policy document guiding the police officers on how to handle people with mental illness. So it is fitting that the police were invited to join this cause.
It has become customary for the Minister of Health to make a fashion statement at this event and deliver a brief address to the audience. Senator Honorable Mary Isaac did not disappoint as she strutted in the colors representing mental illness, adorned in an outfit by Lisa Batten-Volney. The minister also challenged the audience to get active by highlighting and addressing issues of mental illness in St. Lucia.
I know that you understand that mental illness is not a decision. It is not a choice. It is a disorder. It is an illness, and it ought to be treated like every other illness, whether it is the flu, a cold, or anything else. It's just another illness. So tonight, I ask one thing of you, to remember that next time you see a mentally ill person, just remember, tomorrow, it may well be you.
Strut for a Cause also provided new budding fashion designers and models a platform to display their talents while contributing to various health-related causes. From the Ministry of Health and Wellness, I'm Glenn Simon, reporting.
The DBS News will continue with sports news with Brian Calixt.
Good evening, welcome to the DBS Sports. We start off with news on swimming. Racers Swim Club will, from December 2nd to December 4th, be hosting the last major swimming event on the St. Lucia Amateur Swimming Association's calendar called the Lucian Grand Prix. The event, which started 4 years ago, is a developmental meet which gives the swimmers the ultimate experience of swimming in a competition similar to Carifta, FINA Worlds or the Olympics. The top eight swimmers in each age group from the events in the morning session will continue to the evening finals for those events. Place winners for the various events will come from the evening finals for those swimming ages 11 and up. With the participation of all clubs in St. Lucia, Lucian Grand Prix also serves as a last chance for swimmers to set personal best times or even national records before aging up on December 31st. Racers will be opening its doors to new members between ages 6 and 12 years. Tryouts will be held on January 14th and January 28th with limited space. In netball, the Sham Fesu K16 continued on the weekend at the VG Multipurpose Sports Complex. St. Joseph's Convent Egress defeated Entrepot Secondary 20-6, while Northern Arrow defeated Toughest 27-14. Boca Secondary also defeated Cyrus Simmons 21-10. In football, the Massey Stoll Social Club has added another event to their calendar of activities. Activities coordinator of the club, Denise Williams, tells us more.
We have a social club, the Massey Stoll SLU Social Club, where we plan all the events. And this one was added on, and it's a big event. It looks like something that we can look forward to in the future, to always having. It can bring communities together. Everybody can come together, enjoy themselves. It's fun. So I think we'll look into it. It's good. 8 locations participating, and today it's Cul-de-sac versus Boulevard and New Dock versus Waterfront. We have a lot of guys interested in football, so we decided that since that's where they're going, we're going with them. So we're looking in the future to have a commercial league to participate. Like, great. They actually put all the effort into it. We just gave them the support that they needed, but they have been so great. They have been working with us on everything. We appreciate it. The turnout is just great today. We have all the stores participating. It's very good. We're looking forward to working with them in the future. We know that they're committed, so we will have a strong Massey Stores SLU Limited team.
We'll be right back with more sports news and action.
Finally from us, on the lighter side. A missing Maltese Pomeranian mix from Florida was reunited with the owner after turning up in New Jersey 3 years later. Bill Kirsten of Fort Lauderdale shared a photo with his newly found dog Bella to a Facebook page dedicated to finding the beloved pet. Kirsten told North Jersey News Bella disappeared while playing outside of his law office in December of 2013. Almost 3 years later, Ashley Abregu found the missing dog wandering around in poor condition, with knotted fur and covered in dirt. Abregu brought Bella to Patterson Animal Shelter in New Jersey, where her microchip helped them get into contact with Kirsten. Kirsten was ultimately reunited with his beloved Bella and said, after a brief adjustment period, she quickly became part of the family again. Time now for the usual reminder. An upper-level trough dumps heavy rains on the island, forcing the closure of schools and putting flood and landslide communities on high alert. A 45-foot catamaran with a 4-member crew is the first Arc Plus participant to cross the finish line. And efforts get underway here to establish a rape crisis center. And that's the DBS News World broadcast. Thank you so much for watching and listening. On behalf of the entire news team, I'm Timothy Polian. It's a very good and safe evening. Goodbye.